What's up, guys? I'm Krim, and this is another episode of Krim's Randomness. Who remembers this video? I'm aware it's already a year ago that I posted about this double base study, and so many of you are waiting for the results. And let me tell you, today is the day we finally go through all the data together with Aurélie Sacher, and she's the main scientist behind Drums Biomac, and with whom I also did all those crazy tests back at the sports lab of the University of Nantes. So, I'm gonna have a Zoom call with her, say hello to Aurélie, and let's hear what she has to say about the ankle motion. All right, Aurélie, it's great to talk with you again. I know you've been busy going through all the data, and finally we can present some results and go into some details. And I have a couple of questions for you. My first question would be, how many drummers came over to the lab participating in those studies? And did you have different levels of drummers, meaning like you had only guys that could play ankle motion, or was it also kind of beginner drummers?
Hi, Krim. Thank you so much for having me here today. I'm so glad to finally talk about the results of the Drums Biomac study. So to answer your first question, 18 expert drummers participated in the study. All of them had mastered the ankle technique for several years and were able to reach speeds of at least 200 BPM. So no beginners were included, only experienced drummers. However, they did differ in terms of endurance and maximal speed using the ankle technique.
Perfect, that's cool. And how long was the overall study going on?
The experiments began on September 2022 and ended on July 24. So we took 8 months to process the results and write the scientific paper. From then and up to this autumn, we will focus on the communication and the results.
Yeah, this always takes a little bit, right? It's so much data that needs to be processed. And yeah, before we go into all those results, it would be maybe interesting to know also what's the main idea behind those studies you're doing.
The main idea is simple. We're trying to understand how some drummers manage to move their feet incredibly fast, sometimes over 10 times per second, without getting injured. It turns out they're not just using strength or speed, but a clever technique that takes advantage of natural reflexes and body mechanics. We also wanted to compare different drummers to figure out why some can go faster than others. Is it muscle control, reflexes, relaxations? That's what we're digging into. On top of that, I wanted to measure how much the bigger muscles, like the glutes, lower back and thighs, are working during the technique. The idea was to check whether some drummers might be putting themselves at risk of pain or injury, especially when playing fast for long periods. So in the end, it's a mix of music, science, injury prevention, all centered around the ankle technique.
Yeah, super interesting. And because you're also a drummer, I guess it's something that you were really passionate about. We have to do all of those tests in a lab, right? Under scientific condition, and that brings me to the next question. Maybe you can tell us a little bit about what kind of experimental equipment and tools you use to measure this ankle technique.
We had motion capture cameras with retroreflective markers, you know, the little gray balls, to track the precise movement of the drummer's legs and feet. It's the same technology used in cinema and video games. We also used electromyography, or EMG, which involves placing small sensors on the skin to measure how hard specific muscles are working. It actually measures the electricity going through the muscle. This helped us see when and how muscles like the soleus, tibialis anterior, glutes, or lower back were activated during the movement.
We have a lot of data. Is it possible to go and look maybe at some of those beautiful graphics you made? Specifically, what I'm interested into is the graphics about the muscle activation. Maybe you can explain a little bit what's going on there.
So I sent personalized reports to each drummer who participated in the lab session. On this first page, we can see a global summary of their results, including an overview of how much their muscles are activated. We measured different muscles from different muscle groups: the rectus abdominis, or the abdominal muscle, the erector spinae, or the spinal erector muscle, the hip flexors. First, there is the rectus femoris, a muscle in the quad, the tensor fasciae latae, a small muscle of the thigh, and the gluteus medius. So it's a gluteal muscle that is interesting and much involved during the ankle technique to stabilize the hips because of the drummer's position in hip abduction, meaning that the legs are spread apart. Of course, we couldn't measure every muscle. We had a limit of 16 electrodes, so we focused on the most relevant ones, especially those involved in hips and posture stabilization, like thigh, hip, and trunk muscles.
I see that you have highlighted them in different colors. I guess green is always a good thing. Yellow, not so much. Red is something that it might be dangerous. What does that mean?
So during the experiment, we measured each muscle's activation level relative to its own maximum, recording during a maximal voluntary contraction test. You did it at the end of the study, you gave everything, and we measured the maximal contraction that you did. This allows us to see how much muscle are activated during drumming and to compare activation levels between drummers in a standardized way. In ergonomic studies, we know that repetitive movements, like the ankle technique in drumming, can increase the risk of injury, especially musculoskeletal disorders. So we used a color code. If a muscle was activated above a threshold of 30% of the maximal contraction, we marked it in red, meaning that there is a potential risk of injury. If it was below that threshold, it appeared in green, which is considered safe. Yellow simply means that the electrode did not work properly, so we don't have data for that muscle. So it's a simple and visual way for drummers to see where their bodies might be under too much strain, especially at high speeds. To go back to the reports I gave you, I put two graphics, so one on the left, for your comfort speed, that is around 180 BPM, and one on the right for your maximal speed, that is 230 BPM during our experiment. In your case, all muscle groups are relaxed and below the threshold at comfort and maximal speed, except for your left gluteal muscle at maximal speed.
Yeah, true. And that kind of explains also, as we pushed me to my limits, that I kind of start to compensate a little bit with swivel technique, which is, it has a similarity to ankle motion, but it's still its own technique because we have a hip rotation going on. This is where the glute activation comes, and it was way more dominant in my left side. And from telling from experience, yes, you highlighted it red, and I can definitely tell that my left side is more tight, and I actually try to change that to minimize that side movement because I do feel some restraints. Such studies as you do are very helpful in order to try to at least avoid this kind of movement. Yeah, so coming back also to the ankle itself, because there's an ongoing debate between drummers and drum teachers. Some drummers say it's more like the shin muscle, the tibialis anterior, if this is the right name, or it's more the calf muscle, soleus muscle. Can we say, looking at the data, that it's both or it's just one? What did the data show us, actually?
So the data shows that it is both, and that was a surprise, actually. So the soleus had a clear activation for 100% of the participants, and its role is to push the pedal. The tibialis anterior, or the shin, had a clear activation for about 90% of the participant. Its role is to slow down the pedal coming back to its initial position. Of course, it's helped by the spring of the pedal, but we showed that the fastest drummers all had clear tibialis anterior activation, especially at maximal speed. I need to precise that I only talk about the soleus muscle in the calf, but the calf is actually composed of three muscles, two gastrocnemius and the soleus. The soleus is the bigger muscle of the three and the most active when you are in a seated position like drummers. We actually verified that using ultrasound imaging. So if we look at your data for the 180 BPM frequency, we can see that on the right side, you are not using that much of the tibialis anterior. It is easily explained by the swivel technique you are using, where the ankle relies also on rotators of the ankle, such as peroneus muscle. In that case, the activation of the tibialis anterior is sparser than in drummers using the vertical ankle technique, because the ankle does not need to move up as much as for the vertical ankle technique. On the left side, however, you do have a clear activation of the tibialis anterior. In that case, we can see a clear alternating activation of the soleus and tibialis anterior muscle. That is the key of the movement, to have soleus activation, then tibialis, then soleus, then tibialis anterior.
What happens if both are activated at the same time? If it goes super fast, what is the outcome of this?
It's the main factor that limits speed in the ankle technique. It is a phenomenon called coactivation, when two muscles activate at the same time, whereas they have opposite role. Every drummer at its maximal speed presents with coactivation of the soleus and tibialis anterior. The ankle is blocked due to opposite forces from the tibialis anterior and from the soleus. Usually you can feel pain in the shin because the tibialis anterior is a smaller muscle than soleus, so it will fatigue quicker.
This is a sensation I guess all of us drummers have felt, the burning shin muscle. In this video right now, we are mainly focusing on my personal results. However, you mentioned you had 18 participants coming over to the lab. And it would be interesting to maybe compare it a little bit. So let's say my ankle motion versus drummer number 15 or number 10. Could you say that each of us are doing a different movement to achieve ankle motion, or are there similarities?
So there are a lot of similarities. Everyone shows oscillations of the ankle that are controlled by the soleus and tibialis anterior, except for swivel, that is a little more complex. The duration of activation are similar, the timings of the movement are similar. However, there are also differences. For example, the amplitude of the ankle oscillation can be very different. So the fastest drummers have large amplitude of movement, which is the signature for a good ankle technique. Others have a very small oscillation. We also see specific movement signatures for every drummer, meaning that every drummer has his own way of mixing different techniques, compensating with a little swivel, for example. There are no two drummers that have exactly the same results. We actually isolated parameters that were specific to fastest drummers. They had less coactivation, meaning that they were able to activate and deactivate alternatively tibialis anterior and soleus. And they were also more relaxed in the trunk and hip muscles, like we saw for your results, for example.
Interesting. So that's maybe the secret behind all the fast drumming, right? Being kind of as relaxed as possible, but also being able to activate the different muscle groups really fast, like without cramping up and trying to be as relaxed as possible.
Yes, exactly. And we see also different types of training online for the ankle technique, and our results point to the training where you train both muscle groups, the ankle extensor, of course, to push on the pedal, meaning in our case the soleus muscle, but also the ankle flexors, meaning the shin muscle, to accompany the pedal when it is coming back.
That kind of describes the sensation I have when I go slower. I try to almost increase the ankle motion, to kind of play away from the pedals. And so that brings me also to the next question, and a question which is for sure really interesting and many people want to know: how much does the pedal setup help you with ankle motion? Did you see differences between all those drummers?
So every drummer came to the lab with their own equipment and took time to set up everything as they wanted. We measured every setting that they had, for example, a bitter orientation, spring tension, draft shaft length, board height. So in the study, we tried correlating these parameters to maximal frequency to see if specific parameters could lead to faster speeds. We did not find any correlation, meaning that there is no global truth about pedal settings. However, given the mechanisms behind the ankle technique, you need an optimal balance of the pedal to maintain the ankle oscillation. That means that the combination of your pedal plus your soleus plus your tibialis anterior must be optimized according to your physiognomy to reach faster speed. The heavier your leg is and the stronger you are, the higher the spring tension must be. If you are not that strong and have a relatively small physiognomy, to not force on the pedal and compensate using your trunk muscle, a medium spring tension is enough and will save you some muscle energy. It is important to note that other factors are also in the loop, like Achilles tendon strain, motor neuron excitability. However, it is important to have a setup which is specific to one's physiognomy and not someone else.
Yeah. Yeah, that also sums it up, that basically we are all different. We have different weight. We have different lengths of our legs. We shift our weight differently, so we have to change the pedal setup according to that. And maybe this is also why trying to copy certain pedal setups you've seen in the internet might not actually work for you personally, because you kind of have to find that specific balance for you. Also learning how to move with the pedal, making sure you are activating the right muscles, and this all needs time to develop. And I'm sure lots of the metal drummers out there are also nerds as I am, so that's why it's super interesting to hear all about that. And would you say that it's done the studies for you? Would you like to continue? Obviously, it's also a matter of funding. I know you need specific fundings in order to continue. Or would you like to actually dive into maybe more complex movement patterns, let's say swivel, for example?
So I was asked to do a study on swivel technique and heel-toe technique. On the short term, for now, I will focus on communicating on the numerous results of the study and also on publishing our scientific paper that is currently under review. Then the swivel technique is very interesting because it requires the same mechanisms of the ankle technique, only in a lateral movement, whereas the ankle technique is vertical. So we have hip and ankle rotation. It would also mean that additional muscles should be measured responsible for these rotations, like peroneus muscle in the leg and abductor muscles in the thigh. Also, I'd like to do longitudinal follow-ups of the participants that came into the lab. A lot of them contacted me saying that they improved their technique using the results from our study and want to do another evaluation in the lab to measure the differences.
Beautiful. Yeah, I absolutely love that. Great. So it's not done. And, you know, if you need someone for swivel technique, you just give me a call.
I will.
I'm coming back to Nantes and we're going to continue the studies. Can we have like maybe a takeaway message for drummers?
So the ankle technique is a complex technique. It is normal that its learning takes a long time.
Yeah.
It mixes mechanisms of motor control, physiological reflexes, and muscle tendon resonance mechanics. So it's important to understand and dissociate hip movements and ankle movements to isolate, for example, full leg motion from ankle technique. If drummers try to go fast without learning the movement, there is a real risk of developing musculoskeletal disorders like back pain, tendinitis. We showed that the key to speed is to stay relaxed, even if it is easy to say.
We always want to do everything immediately. I'm including myself right here. But then I guess the body always shows us the limits and we should listen to those. It just takes time to develop. But yeah, I want to say thank you, Aurélie, that you are making such studies. I mentioned this before and I will say it again. We drummers are the super nerds and we always are looking into optimizing our playing and our movement. And such, you know, topics and such studies help us dive into this deeper and maybe change our playing habits. So yeah, thank you very much that you took the time. And I hope also you guys watching this video really enjoyed it. You know what to do. Subscribe, follow, comment, like, and share this video with everyone. Please also support Aurélie and Drums by Amag. And we're gonna see each other in the next video. Take care, guys. Bye-bye.